Samke. Finally.
I know, right?
Oh my God. This moment is like so surreal for me.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's real. It's real. Ladies and gentlemen, pulses across the borders, those that are tuned in online, locally. Samke Mhlongo and I are literally meeting for the first time.
In life.
In life. Like right now, she's like sitting across from me. And I'm like, I thank God for my people skills.
Yeah.
I do. I thank God for my people skills, because I think if I didn't have like proper people skills, you would not be sitting across from me right now. And I want to thank you for that, for opening up your heart to this girl.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're, I think you it's your heart. I don't think it's your people skills. I think what you have can't be taught.
Ooh.
I think what you have also can't be learned. Those that are.
Wow. Okay. You're already dishing out things. Let's slow down. Let's slow down. So, Samke, you are on a segment that we call Dress Up. And on this segment, I talk to the pulses, who are my family, day in, day out. I sit with them between 12 and 3 o'clock, Monday through to Thursdays. And we just talk about life. We catch up. So my show, The Pulse, is what you would call like the magazine type of radio, like the magazine that has come alive.
Yes.
And you know, when you open any magazine, you will find something to do with lifestyle and dressing up. And
yes.
So we're taking a twist to today's segment on Dress Up.
Yes.
We have been talking about, you know, how to dress for the occasion, how to put yourself together. I mean, you are here looking absolutely amazing, and it's just a radio interview, but you put thought to what you were going to wear today.
Yes.
So that's what we want to talk about with our listeners today, and then take it a step further to dressing up your mind, because we can be put together, but if we don't dress up our mind state with a certain type of attire, we just look good and we are empty.
100%.
Yeah. So I'm going to throw 100 questions at you, and then it's like, go.
Let's go.
And then it's like, go. Right. So, Samke, this morning you woke up and you had to pick an attire. What comes to your mind when you're picking an outfit that's going to carry you through the day?
Easy one for me this morning, because I got dressed at the Meekles Hotel. Right. I am from out of town and I'm here for a night only. So I brought my hand luggage. I've got only 2 outfits. But those 2 outfits, so I didn't have much choice this morning, but I had choice when I was packing. And when I was packing, I was packing clothing that I don't need to say anything for you to recognize that the power has just walked into the room.
Mm. Oh, yes, girl.
Okay?
Okay.
So, I mean, you guys can watch live on, we're both live on Instagram.
And yes, and Facebook, also on the Capital
on the
Facebook
Capital,
page.
Yeah. Right. And you'll see that it's a beautiful South African designed dress, floor length. So it's not even like, oh, revealing or oh, whatever the case is, but it's just regal. And for me, that regality is my identity. Mm-hmm. So my clothing are a reflection of the personal brand.
Right.
So they speak before me, before I've spoken, but the intellect, the conversation, the value that I leave on the table then backs up what the clothing has said for me before I stepped in the room. Because it's easy for someone else to go and buy the same dress, but will people experience the same brand
within that same fabric?
Yes.
Okay. Now you just took it a whole notch higher. I was just here teaching them, okay, take a black skirt and a white blouse and match it and all of that. And then you come here with the, come on, man, the outfit is going to say something about you.
It opens the door, but it's your personality that walks through.
Okay, so this is Samke talking to a 37-year-old young lady.
Yes.
Who has no idea what to do with her wardrobe.
Yes.
What is Samke saying?
Wear a single color at a time. The British royal family actually does this. It's royal protocol. Okay. If you've noticed, the Queen of England, the Dukes and Duchesses will wear a palette. Or more often than not, actually, the duchesses, when they wear a dress, it'll be a single color. And wearing a single color is the easiest way to immediately elevate your outfit to make it look classier. So if you go through my Instagram, you'll find that more often than not, I'm wearing a single color, head to toe. And it just brings everything together effortlessly. Of course, today is the wrong day to say that because I'm wearing print, but I'm wearing a single
print.
It's like
a single print.
Head to the freaking floor.
Yes. Yes. And it is doing the most.
Yes.
And then I see you accessorized with the pearls.
Yes.
Like, okay, definitely clothing has a story around it. You've got the South African print that you paired up with pearls.
Yes.
Right? Different sides. Like I can see them on both ends.
Yes.
What's the story that your clothing should be telling about you as a person?
The pearls for me are very nostalgic. My grandmother had a string of pearls for as long as I can remember.
Right.
And I was raised by my grandmother. And you know that our gogos still believe in that old school dressing up. Mm-hmm. And for me, pearls just remind me of the traditional values, decorum, how you carry yourself.
Oh, yeah.
You know, how would you behave if your grandmother were watching?
Yeah, those that were raised by an agogo. If your granny was to see the way you are dressed today, what is Ugogo saying about the way that you are dressed? What is Ugogo saying? 0719-100-404. That is the number to get in touch with me or Samke on WhatsApp with your comments, questions, or your contributions. Samke, you said in your intro there, right? What I read out, rather. You are a co-founder and CEO of TWAA, which is Africa's first women's only social commerce technology platform. That's a mouthful, but you are doing the most. What is TWAA?
TWAA, oh my gosh. And I love the fact that we are discussing this on this platform.
Right.
Because as women, we know the importance of, you know, dressing how you want to be addressed. We know the importance of branding. Because your clothing is part of branding, right?
Yes,
and it says something about you and then how people receive you. And so with TWAA, it's a commerce, a social commerce platform, meaning it's social networking with the intention of commercializing, making money, earning a living, creating wealth, using who I am, my personality, my skills, my talents. So if I am good at cooking, I can have a cooking community where I show people how to make lunch for the children, which is affordable, how to make quick Sunday meals, which are pleasing to your husband and your mom-in-law, how to, whatever the case is, I can use who I am and turn that into a community that pays me a monthly subscription for then sharing daily, weekly, monthly valuable tips to help them in that journey or fulfill the need around that specific area. So we are in the era globally of storytelling. You look at companies, they're all about storytelling as a means for their advertising. You look at politics. Politics is nothing more than storytelling, a narrative, getting you to believe something about you and the leadership you're choosing. And now, who are the greatest storytellers in history? It's Black women. It's African women. That's how we passed down knowledge. That's how we passed down information. That's how we entertained the children and our family. And so you use that storytelling ability in the storytelling era to get onto a digital platform and form a community that buys into your story. And your packaging, your personal brand, is how you now say to the world, this is who I am, this is the story, and this is the value you get from me and being part of my community. So this is legitimately the single biggest opportunity Black women have had in all of history to create wealth in the storytelling and digital era.
What does TWAA stand for? Is it an acronym? Is it a saying? Because you're from South Africa. At this point, we don't know if TWAA is almost like a yebo yes type
of thing. It's Swahili, actually.
It's Swahili.
Four. And TWAA, those capitals are a command. It's like, go, jump. And the meaning of TWAA is acquire. So it's an instruction and a command to women to say, acquire, occupy, take up your position in society, in history.
Love it. Love it. No, I was so sure it was some acronym. We were ready for it.
No.
We were ready for it. Like
TWAA, Tata.
Tata.
Yes.
All right. Okay. We've got messages coming through. I think this one is from 081. 081, okay, types in Shona though. So I'll try and break it down. And the pearls are traditional kwatiri isuva novatema kubirarini. As in, you mentioned that the pearls that you are wearing are a traditional, or have a traditional meaning for you because of your grandmother.
Yes.
Right? So she's saying, or he or she is saying, Samke, we're African. Where do pearls come in and our tradition?
Well, my grandmother went to a mission school. called Inanda Seminary,
okay,
which was established by English missionary women. So they were taught and brought up in very British traditions and mannerisms. Ah. So we love having amnesia and pretending that we don't have a huge British influence in how we do things.
Oh,
even us drinking tea is a British custom. So let's now all of a sudden not pretend we want to pick and choose what is African, what is not. My grandmother wore pearls since the she was born in 39. She wore pearls since the 70s. I was born in 1985. Mm-hmm. And from pictures of me with my grandmother as a baby, she's wearing pearls, honey.
Yes.
So if your Ambuya didn't wear pearls, that's okay. That is your tradition.
Yes.
Pearls are mine. Let mm-hmm. me own my story. Let me tell my story. And my story doesn't have to be your story for it to be legitimate.
Right. So there you have it, 081. I hope you were answered in that. And then you've got welcome messages, 042. This is Ursula, I'm sure. Ursula says, welcome, feel at home.
Yeah. My Tabasa.
Oh, there she goes. Who's been teaching you? Talk to me.
Girl, you know I was married to a Zimbabwean.
Hey, that's a story for another day. I think for now, let's focus on dress up. All right, we're talking all things dress up with Samke Mhlongo, but we're not only talking attire. We were going to get into the whole bathing aspect because it's now getting hot. And and then we've got people who use public transport. We have an issue this side in Zim. I don't know if it's the same in SA. Uti, when you use like a taxi, I'm a taxi,
ET,
right?
Yeah.
ET, right? This side, we call them combis.
Yeah, yeah.
So when you get into a combi, there's the conductor.
Yes.
And there's two people in this combi. There's the driver.
Yes.
And then there's the windy.
Yes.
Who is the conductor, right? So this windy, at times, about gays in some gay.
Ooh.
And not only them, right? Then some of the people who are in this combi, they look nice.
Yeah.
But it's that
body odor.
Yes, that body odor.
Strong.
Very strong one. How does one deal with it? Like, you are looking nice.
Yeah.
But your outfit is not complete if you're not smelling good. I mean, I just hugged you now and it was like, okay, the outfit is complete. Like, she looks good, but she smells good too.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. I think first of all, we need to remember that we can't smell ourselves. As a person, you cannot smell yourself. So you could be stinking up the place,
mm-hmm.
clogging people's lungs, and you'll have no idea because you can't smell yourself. So do me a favor, before you leave the house, just ask someone, mom, dad, my sister, your husband, your friend, like, you know, am I smelling good? Am I smelling fresh?
Mm.
Just checking, because you don't know. And ladies, let's talk about sanitary wear. We have fluctuating cycles. Sometimes a panty liner is your friend, honey. Just let it do that little extra job.
Thank you.
To make sure that, you know, the normal female discharge is not letting everybody know that you're ovulating. They don't need to know.
Yeah.
It's not everybody's business.
It's Victoria's Secret.
No, it's Victoria's Secret, honey. You don't need to let the world that the womb is preparing to be with child.
Yeah.
Okay. And it's a very distinct odor. And let's also know when it's healthy, when it's not. Let's have our annual checkups. Let's make sure we're eating healthy. We're drinking a lot of water. Let's also not leave the bathroom after using a public bathroom. And it looks like, you know, there was a nuclear reaction in there when we walk out. Let's make sure that we are drinking our water. Okay, so make sure that, number one, you are bathing properly. You are using roll-on. And I have to admit that in many economies, deodorant and roll-on is a luxury in terms of how it's priced. But let me tell you something.
Okay.
The price of not smelling good is far higher in terms of your job opportunities, promotion opportunities.
Mm.
I'm not going to sign a deal to work with someone if their armpit slaps me in the face every time I open the door
to a
meeting.
Yeah.
And one thing I must commend Zimbabwe on, guys, I love your new airport, eh?
Oh, thank you.
Before 2021, the armpit used to welcome you. That's how you knew I've landed in Harare, because twa in your face.
Yes.
So now I'm just like, where's that familiar kwapa smell? And Zimbabwe's
no, baby.
We've gone electric.
Yes.
Our tiles are shining.
Yes.
Come through border control.
Yes.
Even us, we're smelling nice.
Yes.
Our carousel is spinning.
Yes.
You don't have to walk around.
It's working.
Honey, the carousel is spinning.
Yes.
At Robert Gabriel Mugabe Airport. I was like, Zim. See you, baby.
Thank you.
That is giving Zimbabwe.
It's giving Zimbabwe.
It is
right?
giving international, baby.
You've got the digital dude. Yeah.
Yes.
Right. You have brought a good topic there in terms of job opportunities and how you present yourself, whether you're smelling good, can get you a deal or not get you a deal. You looking the part can either get you a deal or not get you a deal. Let's get into dressing up your mindset, because now we're okay. You've taught us, yes, but please dress nice, your singular colors, you know, think royal family, mm-hmm. and you're good to go. My mind is not okay. How am I dressing up my mind, the things I think about? How am I dressing up my mind for money, for the kind of money that I want? How am I dressing up my mind for the kind of job that I want? Or how am I just dressing up my mind for the things that I want in life?
First of all, in a TWAA community, this is our paid membership community. It's right. actually the TWAA collective.
Right.
So the collective is a community within a community where we do daily coaching to help women get into the mindset of success and making money. Because remember, if success were the inevitable outcome of hard work, then Black women would be the richest people on earth. We know it's not. There's a mindset gap. So we wake up every morning and have a mindset segment and have a theme for the week. My favorite theme from the weeks that we have done is where you wake up in the morning and ask yourself two things. Number one, who has my peace? Mm-hmm. So why is it that I'm not feeling at peace? Am I feeling sad? Am I feeling low? Am I feeling scared? Whatever the case is, who is making me feel uneasy? And what steps do I need to take to get my peace back from them? Mm-hmm. So is there a difficult conversation I need to have? Is there someone I need to set boundaries with? Is there a manager I need to tell, actually, I don't like the way you spoke to me yesterday? Is there a husband I need to tell that, actually, honey, we need to have some serious conversations because you're working late at night, every night, but then the paycheck isn't growing. What is actually going on? Is there a small house? Is there a parent I need to tell that, mama, you can't be asking me for money every week because mm-hmm. it's now starting to put a strain on my finances, and I budget for my home. I've got my own savings goals, my financial goals, and I don't actually owe you for having raised me. So that is who has my peace. Because the difference between those people that are successful and those people that aren't mm-hmm. is the ability to have difficult conversations. Mm-hmm. So number one, even have difficult conversations with yourself. Am I happy with self, with the life that I have built for self? And if not, how have I let myself down, and what do I need to do about it? Then number two, who has my money? Where is my money sitting? Maybe I'm an entrepreneur and there are certain prospective clients that have my money. Mm-hmm. Maybe I am an employee individual and actually, guess what? My manager's sitting with my promotion. I've been in the same position for 3 years without a promotion when I was promised that in 18 months I'd move. So where is my money? Right? And those two of dressing your mind to say, I need to take action in order to have the desired outcome for the life I want results with me. It's taking back power and agency over your outcome. But it starts with being intentional every morning about number one, who has my peace? Who has my money? Mm-hmm. What do I need to do about it? And then executing the day, being proactive and getting from the day that which you have set, as opposed to being reactive. Oh, I don't know what I'm going to find at the office today. Oh, I hope my husband doesn't make me mad when he gets home. Oh, you're just always playing defense. Nobody, no sport, no battle has ever been won playing defense.
Ooh. Okay, take us there. Take us there.
You need to attack. Oh, how do I know? Oh, I've been praying, God. Oh, how do I? When will my life change? Where God is like, when? I'm waiting for you also. Some of you, this conversation is the answer to a prayer you've been praying, but you're waiting for God to somehow say, okay, Mtanami, here's an envelope mm-hmm. with $10,000 on the floor. The $10,000 is the gems being dropped in this insert that you're listening to on your phone, in that taxi, in your car, maybe in the office listening to it, by the way. Yeah. And this may be the sign you've been looking for, that actually it is you. You are standing in the way of you.
By myself.
Yes. Your future self is begging you to have the conversations you're avoiding, is begging you to take the decisions you're avoiding, is begging you to stop waiting for life to happen, but for you to dictate what life should be. Are you always going to wait to be dished out life's outcomes, or are you going to stand up and go to the buffet of life and say, that I like, that I'm not having, that, no thank you?
Is that even possible? Is that possible to go and tell life that, okay, you're not dishing the kind of food that you want to dish for me? I'm going to do buffet service from now on.
Baby, I was like, life, I'm not happy with this husband. I said, roll in the next one. I said, life, I'm not happy with this career. Let's go into tech. I said, life, my passport needs to go for a walk. We're in Zimbabwe. I said, come now.
Okay. Conscious decisions that you implement on purpose.
Yes. But you first need to know the destination. Me, I knew I wanted to be in Harare on Monday and Tuesday.
Right.
So God was like, okay, Mtanami, here's a business trip. Here's a ticket. Many of us have a ticket, but we don't want to board the plane. Because by boarding the plane, you're also leaving some people on the ground.
All right. All right.
But now you want everyone at the airport to come with you. They don't have boarding passes. So two things are going to happen. Either you board that plane, you leave them behind, or you can stay and miss your plane. Chill there with the woman working at the sandwich kiosk. And when just because she's at the airport, you think she's going to the same place as you.
Oh, come on. Come on. You can be in the same place, but going to different places.
Not everyone at the airport has a boarding pass.
When you might serve in the plane.
Yeah, someone you have more pass.
And others are boarding the plane.
Yes. And then you say, how is Samke and Harare, she boarded? She boarded the plane when the boarding call was being announced. Queen, 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 flight 204, ready for boarding. When, oh, but I'm funum gana masale. Oh, she munyasha, unyasha.
Gone.
She's making sandwiches. Leave her. Also, know when to leave people that are now not aligned with where you're going.
You know, you say this. On Monday, we have what we call Hustle Hard with George Billionaire. And he was saying the same thing, but he was talking to us about the six people that you need in your life, like six important people that you need in your life. And one of the things he mentioned was there's people at your level that you grew up with. You was chilling at the bridge with them in the location there. But now your life has moved. It has soared. You're doing things differently to what they were doing now. It doesn't mean now because you are now there, you have to drag everybody else with
you. No, a plane has limited seats. Has limited seats. Even if all the plane that were in the airport were to take off, not everyone in the airport would have a seat. And also, it's not for you. You are liable to your purpose, first and foremost.
Yeah.
And for me, purpose is God. Friends will come and go. People will come and go. Do good to all, but know when it's time to leave. And don't make apologies for the fact that you are growing. Then it means that you're letting yourself down.
And I've got no one to blame in that instance because I am doing it to myself.
Yes. You preach that you want to grow. You preach. You say with your mouth these things, but actually in your actions, you don't align with that. Actually, I'm afraid to grow. I always quote Napoleon Hill, Think and Grow Rich. He says, You are what you think, not what you think you are. So you can say, oh, I want to wake up early tomorrow. But the person that hits the snooze button the person that gets up are two different people.
Yeah.
So actually, you're not the person that wakes up in the morning. You are the snooze button.
But you want to wake up in the morning. But when it happens, when the time...
No, you actually don't want it. You want to think you want it.
Okay, we'll be
right back. You'd like to believe you want it.
What? You want to believe that this is what you want.
Yes.
If you really want
it's comforting. It's comforting to believe
nice
that I'm the type
one.
That wakes up to run.
Yes.
You are not. You're sleepiest.
Okay. We'll add that word to the vocabulary. Message from 918918. Thank you so much for getting in touch with us. This is Chiwa Pabuda's and she is more than a preacher. Thank you.
You are welcome. Someone send around the offering basket.
Yes, we'll send through the offering basket in a little bit. We're talking dress up with Samke Mhlongo, and we took a twist to it today. We did talk about, you know, dressing up and dressing to where you want to go. And then we said, you know what, Samke, let me just pick your brain a little bit. How do we dress up our minds for the places that we want to go to? Ursula, we're not yet done. We will stop when you are done. We will stop when you have learned that you are a sleepiest and you're not taking action for the things that you want. Wow. We will not be sleepiest here as the pulses. If you say you are, you know what irks me also are people who say they belong to the 5 a.m. club.
Yeah.
I think I've spoken to about 3 or 4 people, and that's the only reason why I'm not part of the 5 a.m. club. I will wake up at 6 o'clock fine and do what I need to do.
Yeah.
I think I spoke to about 3 or 4 people who claim to be in the 5 a.m. club. And I'm like, what are you doing at 5 a.m.?
Yeah.
I know, I'm just up. And like, there was nothing that was tangible. There was nothing that was specific that hit me and went, I need to be in the 5. Tell me you're praying or something. Tell me you're planning your day. Tell me you're giving yourself an hour for yourself. Tell me something. No. I couldn't find it. So I was like, no 5 a.m. club for me, thanks.
And the thing is, there's actually a timetable. If you've read the book, The 5 a.m. Club, there's actually a timetable that tells you that when you wake up at 5 a.m., that's what you're doing for the first 20 minutes, and then 20 minutes after that, you're doing X, and 20 minutes. So you can't, you're not part of the 5 a.m. club. You are just someone that wakes up at 5 a.m.
Thank you. No, for me, it was like, give me something that I can ride on, because I liked the idea of saying, I wake up at 5, but what am I doing at 5?
As the Bible says, they shall be known by their fruits.
I mean, they shall be known by their fruits. Ursula says that. Okay, if it's in Shona, I'll translate. Akubata mangwe ma body parts ang sosha kwan.
What does that mean?
You are getting too personal. you are really in people's garden, and you are like, it's okay. It's okay. I think you spoke to a couple of sleepies here. So let's go deeper into this sleepism thing that we are doing. So we like to talk the talk, yeah, but we don't walk it.
No.
Why is that? What's happening with our mind? How are we not dressing it up for that particular thing that we say we want?
Because it's hard. As simple as that, it's hard. It's hard to wake up at 5 in the morning and go for a run. It's hard to say no to particular food because you're on a vegetarian journey. It's hard. And your body will resist what is hard. Your mind also resists what is hard. And remember, we operate from two planes, the conscious mind and the subconscious mind.
Mm-hmm.
So in the conscious mind, we want to wake up at 5 a.m. We want to go for a run. We want to meditate. We want to eat only fruit and vegetables. We want to drink 3 liters of water per day. But your subconscious mind is like, no, thank you. I'm happy where I am. So it's actually an exercise of self-awareness,
mm-hmm,
for the things you say and the things you do to be aligned, for the person you think you are, mm-hmm, and the person you actually are to match. And that is where success happens.
Okay, this is me writing notes, pulses. You know how you do with these notes?
That is where success, yeah, happens.
We hear a lot of talk about subconscious mind and this mind and all of that. Which part of our mind actually kicks in when we want to get things done?
It's the conscious mind, because now you're like, okay, if this doesn't happen, I'm going to suffer these consequences.
Mm-hmm.
And remember, as human beings, we're pain and loss avoiding. That's why some of us only do things when there is pain to be had by not doing them, instead of doing things based on the pleasure to be gained by doing them.
Well, are we drawn to pain?
We're not drawn to pain, but we're just pain avoiders instead of being pleasure seekers.
I'd rather avoid the pain
of embarrassing myself by getting on a public stage and speaking my mind,
mm-hmm,
instead of deriving the pleasure of potentially touching lives.
So we never look at the pleasure that comes with doing,
unless you get into a level of self-awareness where you, mm, say, I am willing to bear this pain. So success is actually a function of the pain you're willing to bear, the pain of failure, the pain of embarrassment, mm, the pain of, mm, your friends saying, who do you think you are? The pain of your family saying, and then what makes you so special that you think you can achieve that? The pain of being laughed at if something doesn't work. So I'm at peace with, I love pain.
So Samke, you are coming through with things here that I've never thought about it. Maybe the pulses have thought about it, but I've never thought about it or seen it in that light.
I enjoy, so if you start going into different types of religions, it's the Baha'i, where, mm-hmm, one of their gods, and I'm Christian, I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, but there are lessons. Just because I'm Christian doesn't mean there are certain lessons that I cannot take.
That's true.
And they have a god that's able to turn anything, even painful things, into things that are beautiful. So it teaches you how to not run away from situations or places or things that are painful. And so, for instance, we're having a TWAA community meetup in Nairobi.
Mm-hmm.
There's an issue of payment. There's a sponsor pulled out. I don't even have my ticket to Nairobi. And I'm in Harare on Tuesday.
Right.
The event is in Nairobi on Saturday. And I've promised my people I'm coming. I don't even know how I'm getting there. But before, that pain used to cripple me and say, I no longer want to find myself in a position where I have to figure things out. So I don't do things unless I'm sure of the outcome. Now, when I woke up this morning with no idea of how I'm going to pay the suppliers, because I'm sitting with money in my USD account in the US,
mm-hmm,
I'm sitting with money in rand, payments need to be made by this afternoon into Kenyan shillings, it's taking 3 days. I'd ordinarily wake up in a panic, but today I was like, I love the pain of having to figure this out. Like it gives me a rush.
Like the challenge, bring it on.
Like yummy. What would life be without challenges or problems to be solved?
And then there's some that will walk away from situations.
Like I'm never going to do that. This is why I only do a business in my region. This is why. Okay, well, then good luck being the queen of Zimbabwe. That's great.
Mm-hmm.
I'm building a global brand.
So I will cross the borders.
So I need multi-currency problems.
Solve multi-currency problems. Hey, Samke, you're coming with it. You are bringing it. You know, like, we need our brains picked like this. Which takes me to what you wrote in your dissertation that you titled Factors Contributing to Overdebtedness of Black South African Female. Can I remove the South African females there and just place Black women? What's our issue with money?
Long story short, we're not as mathematically sophisticated as men. Long story short, we don't earn as much as our male peers. So the gender income gap, there's now a rise in female-headed households. We're not like our grandmothers and mothers who used to stay in marriages that don't work out, we leave. Mm-hmm. And so if you marry those, meaning I earn less, I manage it worse than my male counterpart, and there's more of us that are single-income households, you've got the perfect storm.
We'll be right back as we continue to speak to Samke Mhlongo on Dress Up. It's Capitalk 100.4 FM, Harare's Heartbeat. Send through your questions, your contributions, all your questions. When we come back, we get into some more. It is Dress Up on Capitalk. What?
Dress Up.
What?
With BeckyK on Capital 100.4 FM.
I can't. They wanna know.
It's BeckyK on Capital 100.4 FM.
So my brain had to take a bit of a breather because Samke was just bringing it. I love having my brain picked because it gives me something to think about throughout the whole day today. I'll be thinking about that, as in, what woman am I when it comes to my finances? What woman am I in the household? What kind of a wife am I? Like, am I moping around and looking for pain or looking for excuses not to get into situations because maybe I might get hurt? What kind of a person am I? So after this whole dress-up conversation, when I put myself together, definitely I'm going to be looking at more than just the cloth. It's really beyond the cloth at this point. Were you ever in a situation where you were not dressed for the occasion and you lost out on an opportunity? Maybe your mind was right, but maybe the outfit was not.
Yes, many times. The one that I can remember is where I lost I lost a contract to train staff members because the one manager said that I wear too much makeup. Yeah, she said, like, my whole appearance is very Barbie doll, and it was an insurer, and she said that, yeah, I wear too much makeup. Now, for me, I have hyperpigmentation. My face is like 10 shades darker than the rest of my body when I'm not in makeup. And so for me, I have to layer the makeup to then have my face look normal, right?
Okay.
And so I was deeply hurt by that because, number one, I should have the choice to show up how I choose. But number two, I've already taken the psychological leap of saying I won't let my appearance deter me from being in public spaces, and then to then be punished for that was extremely painful. So my makeup.
Can you imagine? I went to one function. I won't mention what the function was. But I thank God my makeup was settled enough on that particular day. But I saw some ladies being asked to wipe off their faces, and I thought, like, but
yeah,
if I feel comfortable with the way that I look, I should be allowed to wear it.
I mean, let's be honest. I mean, there's some colors where you're just like, girl. Okay, there are. And try look. I always say to people, you know, try look like your shoulder.
Is that
like
you checking yourself? So this is what she's doing, guys. She's live on her Instagram. She just took off her shave, and she's just like, check that. The face and the shoulder.
They match, right?
Yes,
yeah.
They
so
do.
I'm trying to look like myself. There are some people who now, how Sister Togozo or Sister Badai
yes.
is now, you know, African on the bottom, and Korean on top. Like, yeah. No, just look. What would you look like if you had perfect skin? What would you look like without the sun damage, without the chemical damage? Without, you know what I'm saying? So try go for that. Even with, you know, your lipstick and your eyeshadow. So if you go through my whole Instagram, you'll realize I don't wear color on my lids.
No, you do.
I wear browns and nudes, like, and my lip is also, you know, the brown liner, the pink center. I will give you money if you have a picture of me wearing red lipstick in the last 5 years.
Oh, okay.
I don't even do color on my lips anymore, because you can look, if you look at how the Nigerians do their makeup, and if you look at how the Black Americans do their makeup, where you've got the nice eye, the shadow created on the eye to make your eye pop, you know, your brows are nicely shaped and they look natural. You don't have one heading for the skies and one or flat or just a straight line across. Also, your lips, you know, don't, like, I see people doing, like, why must your eyelid look like a peacock? So, I mean, actually, if you want to, that you do use this, you know, if you want to, you
like,
do you.
Like,
do you? All I'm saying is, I like the shades I use on my face, my eyeshadow, my blush, my lipstick, to be shades that would appear on human skin. So, variations of browns and nudes.
What's your take on the old money look?
Oh, I'm all for that. I'm all for the old money look. I think it's clean. I think it's very subtle and says what needs to be said. But at the same time, don't deny yourself the different phases. If you just got money last week from a big deal, honey, and you want everyone to know, and you want to be purple eyeshadow, green lipstick, honey, celebrate, it's your time. You understand?
Right.
But also know the opportunity cost of doing that, right? Mm-hmm. So every decision has an opportunity cost. Also, what's the point of dressing old money if you ain't got the money? You know, so listen and manifest it, honey. Yes. For me, I operate from my truth. You've got people who've made tons of money who say, this has always been my dream to dress like this. Iris Apfel, the 101-year-old Jewish grandma in the U.S. has a big round glasses, and she's very great. She's found her signature. And I think more than anything, whether you choose to wear color, whether you choose to wear plain, whether you choose to have green eyeshadow or blue, be authentic to you in that moment. I think that's what matters, because when you're being inauthentic, it actually comes through. So I'd rather you look like the colors of the rainbow and it's your authentic personality than try look old money, but we're like,
question mark, it's not mathing.
Yes.
Do you think also your choices have got to do with maturity?
Yes.
Right.
Self-awareness.
Self-awareness.
Because you can be young and have an extremely high sense of self-awareness. Mm-hmm. And you can be one foot in the grave and have no clue who you are. You're just a kite going with the wind and the trends.
Yeah.
So for me, it's a function of self-awareness and being able to stand true to what you've said for years to come. So I want to be able, like, whenever I do anything in public, I say to myself, would some get 10 years from now? Would some get 20 years from now? Would my granddaughters, you know, listen to this clip and not think, oh my God, my grand, but be like, yes, me, yes.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I want.
Oh man, we've got 10 minutes left with Samke Mhlongo. Ursula says, yeah, your laugh is just amazing. Continue laughing. We love it.
Thank you.
Like, yes. And then, that wasn't Ursula. Sorry, Ursula. Hey, I read the wrong message. This one is from 893, and yes, just let her keep laughing. Her laugh is just doing it's just doing the thing. Ursula was the one whose body parts you were just tempering. You were in her garden. But I'm sure, you know what? Normally when an expression like that is said, it means you have hit the right nerve and someone's life is about to change.
I love that.
With what you are sharing with us. So this is now Samke Mhlongo. You've changed professions how many times before you landed on the one that you are now happy with?
Oh, honey, my dad wanted me to be an accountant, so I've been a trainee accountant, left that, was a banker, left that, was an entrepreneur running her own financial wellness practice.
Right.
I've been an author, I've been on a reality TV show, and not a business one, like a lifestyle, you know, real divorcees of Joburg type.
No, tell them which reality show you were on. We watch, tell them.
Nah, they don't deserve that kind of advertising from me, it's cool. And it's okay.
Okay, I'll and tell you know, when
I've been
gone.
An author. I've been, you know, it's all these things. I've lived. I've scratched each of my curiosities, mm-hmm. and that's why, you know, I'm able to take a decision and stand by it because I'm not easily distracted. If someone were to put down $1 million check and say some get beyond this reality show, it's like, been there, done that. You know, I know the margins or the returns. No, thank you. Or the price you need to pay, no thank you. Mm-hmm. You know, if someone says, Samke, I've got an executive job for you, I know I'd be like, no thank you, honey. Office, managing people, I can barely manage myself. I'm good, you know, let me deal with my team of admins, mm-hmm. you know, running TWAA. So I've changed many times. And what I'll say is this, the vision has remained the same. Mm-hmm. The mission has changed. What's the difference? Your vision is your destination, your mission is your vehicle. So my destination of female economic empowerment has not changed. When I was on the reality show, it was about empowering women. My book is about empowering women. Yeah. Our community is about empowering women. Mm-hmm. When I was a banker, it was an entrepreneur, rather, it was about empowering women. When I was writing a finance column in Bonner Magazine, it was about empowering women. So the destination and the vision and the purpose has remained the same, but the vehicle has changed.
And are you happy with this vehicle that you're in?
Girl, I'm going to a tech summit next week in Zambia. I'm trying to meet them tech boys, you know, trying to tell that tech.
No, I'm sorry. Oh my gosh.
Trying to meet the next Mr. Samke. I'm trying to, you know,
the next Mr. Samke.
I like it.
All right, so final question on the dress up before we get into some serious questions. What does the role of fashion have to do with elevating one's happiness? Do they have a link? Do they correlate?
I do believe that there is a link, and I will tell you why. I have found that when I dress in a way that expresses who I am or who I see myself as at that time, mm-hmm. I carry myself differently. Put another way, I have found when I've been too broke in that moment, or my cash flow is not allowing me to wear that outfit I want to wear, maybe it's an interview, maybe it's me speaking on the stage, I actually show up differently. So I do believe it's very important for you to have the affordability to let your clothes be an expression of who you are at that point in time.
Yeah.
To love the reflection you're seeing in the mirror. I remember when I was going through my divorce and, you know, I'm paying legal fees, I'm paying this and that, times are tough. And I'm already my emotions, I'm feeling down. And then I'm getting dressed for work. And you know when your blacks are no longer black? Like, you know, yeah, your skirt
it's
is now.
Like a gray black. You're not so sure.
Yeah, it's
white,
got
black, gray black. What's going on? It's shiny.
You know, the flower, man. Yes. Or it's shiny. We keep it, you took it out of, you know, and already you're just going to work and you're not feeling powerful. So yeah. I do think that there is a definite correlation between, you know, and it's not so much what you're putting on, because it can be cheap, it can be expensive. And I've always told people, me, I can take something from the market and make it look like $1 million.
Oh, yeah.
Depending on my state of mind, yeah? But it's about being in love with what you see in the mirror. And that is what I hope will be the reality of the people that have been listening here today, men and women. Just when you look in the mirror, you're like, I like what I see. Because when you've got the armor of loving yourself, when you step out of that house, right, to conquer the world, it doesn't matter what other people say about you. Ooh, it doesn't matter what challenges you face. Mm. Remember that other famous quote, you know, when there's no enemy within, the enemy without can do no harm.
Nothing. It can't do
no.
Okay. All right, Samke Mhlongo, all the way from South Africa, came to pay us a visit, and she was our guest for Dress Up. Now we're going to get into some serious questions, Samke, before we play the song that you requested. And of course, it's going to get us dancing as that song takes us to the 2 o'clock news. We are packing our bags to go somewhere. Where are we going?
We're going to Nairobi.
We're going to Nairobi. What's happening in Nairobi?
We're having the TWAA community meetup, honey, on Saturday. It's a pajama party.
It's a pajama.
I don't want fleece. I don't want sleep time. I don't want teddy bears. I want Instagram pajamas, Lala. I want satin. Okay. I want feathers. Okay. I want things to flow.
Right.
Things must fly when you're walking through the passage.
I can see it already.
I want drama.
I think. What was her name on Generation Queen Moroka?
Yes. I want drama. I want movement. Right. I don't want, you know, your bunny slipper, please.
Okay. Right. Let's keep it TWAA. Let's keep it TWAA. All right. You've got two kids. What stands out the most about the kids that you have?
Oh my God. Oh, they holding my children in my arms was the first time that I loved anyone more than I love myself. I truly understood the love of God and the love of laying down your life for another when I held my babies in my arms for the first time. And every time I see them, I mean, as moms, I think we have a difficulty in letting go of our children.
Mm-hmm.
And I just look at them and marvel and say, wow, you know, you love something so much, but you have to let it go because they're growing. They've got their own personalities. They've got their own views of the world. But my children are just, they're my heart walking outside of my body.
You should see how you just like, you just went from woo to
oh, they're like, my heart.
Nice and soft.
They're my heart walking outside of my body. I'm incredibly proud of them. I would get in front of a moving train for them without thinking about it.
Oh man, absolutely. Okay, there's my BBB. Well, the TWAA, I know H Pagati. It's just TWAA and the TWAA in Damanaskana, as in Hambandom.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Capital 100.4 FM, 2 minutes to news time. And this is what Samke says. You know what? Nothing says South African like this.
I can't believe an hour just went by like that. I don't even know the
dustbin. We are done and dusted. Man, just wait to go to the news and then
okay.
Take pictures.
Yes.
And thank you so much. You poked people's brains.